Jason. I have a question. Whoa, man, that's loud. Okay, you already heard the question, so most of you should be prepared to answer it by now. And the question is, what does it take to build a truly great church? Now, I'm talking about the church that you get up on Sunday morning and you're excited about the opportunity to go to church. The kind of church where you want to tell your friends at work or your friends at school this week about how awesome your church was. What does it take to build that kind of church? Now, if I was asking you what it takes to build a church building, some of you would say it takes bricks and it takes nails and it takes wood, but that's not what I'm asking. I'm asking, what does it take to build a truly incredible church? And I need your opinion on it. So what do you think? Brandon.
Volunteers.
It takes volunteers. Somebody else. Go ahead, way back there in the back. Worshiping God? It takes worshiping God to build a great church, yes. Okay, it takes relationships with other people. Go ahead. Lots of prayer.
Love.
It takes love to build a great church. Anything else? Go ahead.
Food and donuts.
It takes food. I knew somebody was going to say Starbucks coffee and donuts. I knew it. Go ahead.
Hard work.
It takes hard work to build a great church. What else do you think?
Lots of money.
Rob says money. It takes money to build a great church. Unless you're in the Army, of course, the Army provides the money for you. Okay. It takes spiritual revival in the hearts of people. Any other ideas about how to build an incredible church?
Teach the word.
Okay. Preaching the word or teaching the word of God. Anything else? Go ahead, back there in the back.
Define direction.
All right. It takes direction or vision for the church. It takes the presence of the Holy Spirit. All of those things are necessary. Brandon, you already gave one answer. One answer limit here. Anybody else? No, go ahead. I was going to say the same thing. It takes really loud speakers in the church to be great. Actually, it's an essential ingredient. Every great church has this one ingredient. And without it, it may be a good church, but it will never be a great church. And that ingredient is great people. Does that mean?
It's a short.
No,
it's the belt back.
Hold on just a second. It takes great people. And great people make a great church. Now, folks, I'll be honest with you. Those great people all have three things in common. I'm about to turn this thing off. Those great people all have three things in common. They all have a willing heart. They have skillful hands. And finally, they all work together with one mind. If you have a Bible, I want you to take your Bible, open it up to Exodus chapter 35. It's the second book in the Bible. We're going to look at Exodus chapter 35 in just a second and see what it has to say about how to build a great church. Now, while you're turning there, I want you to understand something. From the very beginning, God created his people to worship him. In the book of Genesis, for thousands of years, God's instruction was, I want you to worship me in the privacy of your own heart. I want you to worship me. By the time you get to the book of Exodus, though, God's ready for his people to assemble together and to worship him in one place. Y'all know the story of Moses, right? Most of you in here are familiar with the story of Moses, how God rescued him from the Pharaoh by putting him in a basket and delivering him down the Nile. How, as a young man, he murdered a man and went on the run in the desert for 40 years. And how, as an 80-year-old man, God met him in the desert by a burning bush and said, Moses, I've got a mission for you. And that mission, to go back and to tell the Pharaoh to let my people go. Let my people go so that they could go to the desert. Now, pop quiz. Why did God want the Pharaoh to let his people go? Yes, the correct answer is God said, let my people go so that they can go into the desert and they can worship me in the desert. I'm going to try this mic one more time. Okay, so his instructions were, let him go so that they can worship me in the desert. Now, God said, listen, you're going to build a special place for me, Moses. After a series of 10 plagues, if you know the story, the 10th devastating, that by the time the 10th plague, the people of Egypt literally gave the Israelites mold. Here's my money, leave. Nothing's more serious. To the desert. God says, you're going to worship me. You're going to build a special. at 10 to worship me, all the people of the world will know that you are my people. Now, this is God's instructions in Exodus chapter 35. You have it up there on the screen for you. But in Exodus chapter 35, God says, you first must build this tent with a willing heart. You must be ready to serve me with a willing heart. Exodus 35, verse 4. Moses said to the whole Israelite community, this is what the Lord has commanded. From what you have, take an offering for the Lord. Everyone who is willing is to bring to the Lord an offering of gold, silver and bronze, blue, purple and scarlet yarn, of fine linen, goat's hair, ram skin dyed red, and the hides of sea cows. Acacia wood, olive oil for the light, spices and anointing oil for the fragrant incense, and onyx stones and other gems to be mounted on the ephod and on the breastpiece. In other words, God said, Moses, you are going to give me everything I need to build this thing, but the one ingredient that I must have is willing people. I with willing hearts. Now, you're going to give me some of your fine possessions. You're going to give me some of your everyday household possessions. Build this temple or this tabernacle, this tent in the desert. But what it absolutely requires is people with a willing heart. And through those people with a willing heart, God was going to build his temple, a special place for the first time ever for him to be worshipped. That's football season, and some of you guys are late till this time of year. Some of you ladies probably think, I can't wait till it's over with. But in football, there is a name synonymous with great coaching. It's Amos Stags. Amos Stags was one of the greatest coaches that the sport has ever known. And Stag always wanted to keep his players involved in the game, even if they were standing on the sidelines. And so Stag was notorious for calling on a player that was on the sidelines and on the spur of the moment, asking them a question to keep them involved. One day, a game was particularly close. And Stag knew he needed to do something to change up the game, to keep the offense on their toes. So he looked for another player that they hadn't seen in some time. Found a young man by the name of Wilson sitting on the sidelines. Now, Wilson had not seen 1 minute of play the entire season, and Stag was considering putting him in the game. But before he did that, he wanted to know that Wilson's mind was engaged. And so quickly, Stag looked over Wilson and he said, Wilson, if this game is tied, it's the fourth quarter, we have 1 minute left to play, the ball is in our possession, and we are 10 yards from the goal line. Wilson, I want you to tell me what you would do. Well, that question caught Wilson completely off guard, and he wanted to impress his coach, but he really didn't know what to say, so Wilson made a mistake and said the first thing that came to his mind. He said, well, coach, if it was that close and we were close to the end zone, I guess I'd slide down the bench towards the end zone so that I could see the last play a little bit better. Now, of course, the coach thought to himself, okay, don't put Wilson in any. Folks, the fact of the matter is this. Christianity, following Jesus Christ, is a full contact sport. There is no room on the sidelines for Christianity. The honest truth is, if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, if your heart is right with Jesus Christ, whether you like it or not, God has placed you in the game, and he expects you to get involved and to serve him somehow. Now, you can be the wide receiver that scores a game-winning touchdown if you want to. You can be the center who is the strength and the stability of the whole front line, or you can be some guy back on the sidelines picking daisies in the sidelines of the infield. But whether you like it or not, you are in the game. God placed you in the game when he changed your heart and made you a believer of Jesus Christ. And it's up to you how much you get involved. It's up to you what you really contribute to God's kingdom. Folks, every one of you has some things that you're talented at that this church needs. We're not asking you to do something that you're not very good at. We're asking you just simply to be willing to do something that you're talented at for this church to make us a better church. I want you to hear something and think about something very carefully. God doesn't need greatness. All God needs from his people is willingness. All God wants is to help out wherever I need to help out. We're simply just parking across the street so somebody else can have a park or close parking spot who visits for the first time. God just simply needs willingness. I want you to hear this too. God doesn't need your ability. What he really needs is your availability. He needs people who say, I'm willing, I'm available, whatever you need, I'll give it so that this church can be a better church. But folks, remember this. Take this home with you and write this down. The true measure of a man or woman's greatness is not how many people or how many servants they have. It's how many people they serve. You want to be a great man or woman? Today, we're going to ask you to get in the ball, to get in the game, and to serve at this chapel. The first thing you notice from Exodus 35 is that the people serve with a willing heart. The second thing that you notice from Exodus 35 is not only do they serve from a willing heart, but they also serve with skillful hands. The people serve with skillful hands. I'm going to read this to you. It's a rather long passage, but you need to hear it because it's important. Exodus 35, starting in verse 10, it says, all who are skilled among you are to come and to make everything the Lord has commanded. The tabernacle with its tent and its coverings, clasps, frames, crossbars, posts, and bases, the ark with its poles, and the atonement cover, and the curtain that shields it, the table with its poles, and all of its articles, the bread of presence, the lampstand that is for the light with the accessories, lamps and oil for the light, the altar of incense with its poles, the anointing oil and the fragrant incense, the curtains for the doorway and the entrance to the tabernacle, the altar of burnt offerings with its bronze gratings, its poles and all of its utensils, the bronze basin with its stands, the curtain with its posts, bases, and the curtains for the entrance to the courtyard, the tent pegs for the tabernacle, for the courtyard, and their robes, the woven garments worn for ministering in the sanctuary, both the sacred garments for Aaron the priest and the garments for his sons when they serve as priests. God said, listen, there is lots of work to do. And I'm going to ask you to get involved and to do something that you're good at or that you're skillful at. Now, I want you to notice God didn't ask them to do something they're not good at. God said, just take what you're already good at. Give that or use that at this church to make this thing a great church. And everyone in the Israelite community, according to Exodus, who had a willing heart, came and they gave. And they made this thing a proper church. Now it said some of you need to work with your hands. Some of you need to work with wood. And those of you who are going to work with wood, I want you to go over here. Some of you need to work with metal. I want you to go over here. Those of you who are good at cooking and baking, I want you to go back here and sew and make cloth. I want you to hear all of you. I need you to work so that we can make this place a church. Serve God. It was an awesome church. And when the church was finished, and the presence of the Lord so thick, that's how thick God's presence was when they had finished this church. God said, simply, all I want you to do is to use your skill at this church. Bruce Wilkins is the author of the Prayer of Jabez. He's folks, listen, if you're a Christian, God created you for a special purpose. And that special purpose is to meet a need that no one else can meet. Something that only you can do. Maybe it's here at this chapel, maybe it's at your workplace, maybe it's with your friends or your family. But it's something for God's kingdom that only you can do. I can't do it, and no one else in this building can do it. And what we're asking you to do today is to get involved with something that you're good at. If you can't change a light bulb at home, we're not going to ask you to come to this chapel and rewire the building for a different, for fiber optic cable. That's not what we're going to ask you to do. We're simply going to ask you to do something you're already good at here at this chapel later on today. Some of you are like a round peg, and God has placed a round hole in this chapel, and you fit completely. And if you don't do that thing, whatever it is that you're good at, there will be a need that goes unmet in this chapel. Some of you are a square peg. There's a square hole here, and you can fit that hole perfectly. But if you don't do it, like Bruce Wilkins just explained, somebody else will have to strap a rope, hang themselves on the side of a cliff to try to meet this one need that you can do perfectly. If you would just simply get involved and say, I'm ready to help out wherever you need help. first thing is those great people served with a willing heart. Secondly, they served with skillful hands. And then lastly, I want you to notice this from Exodus 35. They all served with one mind. Exodus 35, starting at verse 20, says, "Then the whole Israelite community withdrew from Moses' presence. And everyone who was willing, whose heart moved, came to him and brought an offering to the Lord for the work of the tent of meetings, for all of its service and for the sacred garments. All who were willing, men and women alike, came and brought gold, jewelry of all kinds, brooches, earrings, rings, and ornaments. They all presented their gold as a wave offering to the Lord. Everyone who had blue, purple, or scarlet yarn or fine linen, or goat's hair, ram's skin dyed red, or the hides of sea cows brought them. They presented those presenting offerings of silver or bronze, brought it as an offering to the Lord, and everyone who had acacia wood or any part of the work brought it. Every skilled woman spun with her hands and brought what she had spun, blue, purple, or scarlet yarn, or fine linen. And all the women who were willing and had skill spun hair. The leaders brought onyx stones and other gems and mounted them on the ephod and breastpiece. They all brought spices of olive oil for the light and the anointing oil for the fragrant incense. All of the Israelite men and women who brought to the Lord a freewill offering for all the work that the Lord through Moses had commanded them to do." Basically, everyone in Israel whose heart was right with God said, "I am going to get involved. I'm going to do something. I can work with wood, and so I'm going to work with wood. I can work with metal, and so I'm going to work with metal. I can cook, so I'm going to cook. I can sew. I'm going to sew so that God's tabernacle, his special tent, will be made exactly like God asks us to make it." Now, folks, I want you to notice something here, because if you're not careful, you'll miss this. God said, "I want you to even include the ladies. Let them add their special talent to this tabernacle." This was at a time where women were treated as property, as animals, and God said, "The ladies in your kingdom are as valuable to me as the men are. I want everyone with one heart and one mind to come together and to work together to make this a great place to worship." They all came together as one team, as one family, and together they made an incredible place to worship, a place to worship that was so great that, again, God's presence, when God filled it, it was so thick that people couldn't even stand in the tabernacle because God's presence was so thick. They did that by being one team, with one mind, with skillful hands, and a willing heart. And through great people, God made it a great place to worship. I remember when a great team, it was the 24th, 1989. On Christmas Eve, I was sitting on an airfield near the border of Costa Rica in Operation Just Cause, the invasion of Panama. I had flown in with about 100 other Marines. We had got some intelligence reports that there were close to several Panamanian defense forces who were massing near the border, who were getting ready to attack U.S. forces. And so after a week of fighting the Panamanian Defense Forces, me and about 100 other Rangers flew into this airfield to secure this airfield. On the way in, two Chinook helicopters got so close to one another that it literally burned out the engine of one and it had to do an emergency landing on the airfield. The short of the story is that this aircraft had to do an emergency landing. They pulled the crew and everybody else off of the aircraft. They put them on other aircraft. And then because of an emergency somewhere else in the country, they flew the rest of the Rangers out, and they left me and my reconnaissance team, five men, to secure this airfield, to hold this aircraft, and to brace for anything that these several hundred Panamanian defense forces that was in the Costa Rican border could do to us. The last words that we got was, "You hold this airfield, we'll be back as soon as we can." So me and four other men set Claymore mines all over this airfield to booby trap it. We took all of the ammunition and all of the weapons off of this helicopter, and we used it to defend ourselves, and then we rigged this helicopter to blow so that if anybody got near it, it would turn into an enormous bomb. And then the five of us went to the control tower where we could see the whole area very clearly. And for the next 36 hours, we watched that aircraft, that airfield, and waited for several hundred enemy forces to overrun us. Now, in the course of this, I had already been up for over 2 days straight, going from operation to operation in the invasion of Panama. And late that night, I got so tired that I literally could not stay awake any longer without standing up on this control tower. But if I stood up, it would give our position away. And so I realized it happened. I looked over at two friends of mine, John and Jeff, and I said, listen, I can't stay awake any longer unless I stand up. And they said, Jeff, don't worry about it. We will take care of it. You go to sleep. We'll watch your sector. Get an hour or two of sleep, and we'll watch your sector for you. Now, folks, I want you to know something. For the next hour, I slept as well as I have ever slept in my life. Not because I was so tired for being up almost 3 days straight. The reason that I slept well is because I knew those two people, and I trusted them completely with my life. I realized that if anything happens, these guys will take care of me. And I slept well because I was part of a great team. I don't know if you know this or not, but if you are a Christian, you are part of an incredible team. In fact, if you're a Christian, the moment that you became a Christian, you became part not only of a team, but of a family. And every Christian in this room, according to God, is a son or daughter of God. That makes us all brothers and sisters in Christ. I don't know if you knew that or not. As brothers and sisters in Christ, we are part of a family, and we have a mission, and that mission is to let the rest of the world know the difference that Jesus Christ has made in our life. And you can do that here at this church simply by getting involved and by helping out. All right, it's almost Thanksgiving time. And when Thanksgiving rolls around, families get together. Brothers and sisters get together, and what do? They eat. That's absolutely right. They sit together, they throw down on a big meal, they all hang out and have a good time together. And I don't know if you realize this or not, but that is almost exactly what happens at Thanksgiving. That happens at communion. At communion, brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ come together, they eat together, they drink together, and together they thank God for what His Son Jesus Christ did. By coming to the same table and saying, I'm part of the family of God, and I thank God for what Jesus Christ did when He paid the price for my sins on the cross. So in just a second, we're going to take communion together as a family. And what we're going to do today a little bit differently is you guys are going to serve one another. Me and a couple of other folks are going to bring some bread by. You can take a piece of bread, and then you're going to serve the person next to you. And then after the bread goes by, we're going to send some juice around, and you can serve the person next to you. Now, I want you to know something. This communion is for brothers and sisters whose lives have been changed by Jesus Christ. If that's not you, simply just let it pass by and hand it to the person next to you. And as you take communion, as JC comes up to play in just a second, as you take communion, I want you to think about the great price and to thank God for what He did when He changed your life and He made you a part of this great team. So, Jason, if you'll come up to play.